The choir has a special number this one entitled Nothing is Impossible. Amen.
Amen.
We pray as you listen that you be blessed and that God be glorified in Jesus' name.
Yeah.
Aleluia. Say after me. Say, I believe and confess.
I believe and confess.
As I'll be taught the word of God today. My mind, you be fruitful. My spirit, you be alive. My spirit, you be alert. My understanding, you produce result. My body, you be held. My life, you will not be the same again. The reason for today, the reason for this special service, the reason for this special revelation, let it be fulfilled, let it be established in my life, in my family, and in the church. I take authority over you, Satan, and I command you to go in the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, have your way without any hindrance. Thank you, faithful Father. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Clap your hands and celebrate God. You're welcome to this service. I'm going to take 10 minutes of your time this morning. When I finish this teaching, I didn't want to disrupt the teaching because we've advertised it and everything is in process. We have a minister of God in our midst, and I received him on Friday in the name of Jesus. When somebody comes into your house or to your city in the name of the Lord, do not but receive them in the name of the Lord. So I will be bringing him as the service closes to give us a word for 10 minutes. Praise the name of the Lord. And we're trusting God that God will bring him back to Christ Church. And then we can plan a proper program as the Lord wills. Join me this morning in welcoming Dr. Anthony. He's a Malay and lives in Dubai. Praise the name of the Lord. Well traveled. He's been to Nigeria to minister. He's been to several places across the world to minister. And he's here in New Zealand. Clap your hands and celebrate God once again. Praise the name of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I believe you want to be blessed.
Yes.
Deuteronomy chapter 30. Hallelujah. This morning, we have a special situation on hand. Since I've been a pastor, and I've been a pastor since 1990, one of the things I enjoy doing is I like teaching 3 Sundays series. I'll teach for 3 Sundays. Have you noticed that I do that here too? But this time around, I don't know, I've heard about divine intervention. All of us know about divine intervention, am I right? I've heard about divine interruption. I've also heard about divine interception. Establish it by trying to bring our knowledge from what we know to what we don't know. Deuteronomy chapter 30, and we're reading verses 19. We have it on the screen. I call heaven and earth to record this day against you that I have set before you life and death. Move your hand to the right and say life and death. It says, I have also set before you blessings. Say blessings. And cursings. Therefore, not God, not your pastor, but you have a choice to make. And the choice is either for life or death. And the choice will either be for cursing or blessing. What will your choice be this morning? What will your second choice be this morning? Come on, say, I make a choice for life. And I reject death. when we stopped last week is that our faith is not only projected or released or given to us to receive. Hallelujah. We said our faith works like the reject and accept button. In other words, your faith can receive things, which is the most popular side of faith lessons that we know about. I use my faith to receive this. I use my faith to receive this. But I told you last week that God said we can use our faith also to refuse. We can use our faith to reject. We can use our faith to stand against something. We can use our faith to oppose something. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. So if we can use our faith to receive and to reject and to refuse and to accept, what will be the tool? What will be the tool of spirituality that God is going to entrust you with to be able to choose life and reject death? What will you use? I said, what will you use, church? With what will you choose life and reject death? With what will you choose blessing and reject curses? What, church? Good. That's one. With your mouth. What else can you use to reject? Say it again. I said, say it again. I said, say it again. Say it again. It is your faith that is the tool that you're going to use to reject and to accept. So make a confession of faith and say, I reject death for my life, for my family, for this church. Accept life. Accept blessings. I refuse curses. Faith in the marketplace. Come on, say faith in the marketplace. So as we have this divine detention, I don't have the full grasp of the reason. But these are my prayers. May God, as He detain us on this point of faith until He releases us to move forward to another subject, crack every hardened heart of unbelief in our midst. How do I know that we have unbelief? I'm having difficulty believing that God will fill these chairs, that one day will come and will not minister to empty seats. And if that is my situation, I have no doubt that some of you have the same situation. Close your eyes. Can you see every empty seat filled? As you see every empty seat filled, in the same way, every empty need in your life will be filled with plenty.
Amen.
It doesn't change. Praise the name of the Lord. It is your faith that is going to move you out into action. It is your faith that is going to move you out to bring the sick on the feet. It is your faith that is going to move you out to look for somebody that has a disease and tell them that we have the power of God visiting us on the 5th of April. Come and test it and see if God will not heal you. Praise the name of the Lord. It is our unbelief that is going to paralyze our attempt and say, whoa, Lord, I've done this, I've invited so many people, but I'm not seeing results. It is your faith that will keep doing it. Come on, shout hallelujah. Close your eyes again, say, Lord, I believe. In the name of Jesus. As God detained us, I'm also trusting God that God's fire will go forth. If you believe, can I hear you say a louder amen? And melt every doubt about God's word. In the name of Jesus. This word of God is unchanging. This word of God never expires. His faithfulness extends to all generations. Praise the name of the Lord. Come on, say faith in the marketplace. So let's get to the knowledge of market. What is a market? How will our faith be in the marketplace? The first type of market that existed was market by search. I don't know, maybe you know. That the first type of market that existed in life was market by search, which we were taught in economics means trade by barter. In other words, you look for somebody that has need of what you have and who has what you need. Hallelujah. It was so cumbersome to do that in those days. So if you need corn and you have yam in your farm, you've got to look around and keep looking and keep searching until you find somebody that needs what you have and have what you need. Praise the name of the Lord. But you know that eventually something that is hard as well came on board. Who said, no, there's no need for us to go house to house and knock on doors and say, do you want this? Oh, I have this. Do you want this? Let's all meet together in a particular location. Let's call it Abame Market. I know you understand what I'm talking about. Let's call it Westfield Mall. Let's call it Walmart and all these other physically located markets all over the world. And people come there physically to buy. And eventually people discover that this is not the best of market. There's still something that is better. Do you know, now we have online market. We have Alibaba Express. We have Amazon online market. And we have Google. Do you know Google is an online market? Facebook is an online market. You don't know. For each of those likes and clicks that you make, somebody is making money. Instagram is an online market. And the money that is being made today from online marketing is bigger than the money that is made in physical markets. Now we're talking about faith in the marketplace. Are we saying this morning that you got to take your faith to Google and start buying things on Google? Am I saying this morning that you got to take your faith to the Facebook marketplace and start selling something so that you can get something? What does it mean to say that faith in the marketplace? What I mean is this. Your faith is either in theory or in practice. Your faith, not in theory, but practically demonstrated in the marketplace of needs and wants in your life, in your family, and in the church, is what it means to have faith in the marketplace. Hallelujah. What do I mean? I'm going to give you some nuggets. My message is not going to be so long this morning, but I'm going to give you some nuggets to give you understanding, and those nuggets are like 9 in classification of what I mean by faith in the marketplace. To have faith is different from using faith. To say, oh, I have faith. If you have faith, good. But it is quite different from saying, I am using my faith. And I kept on telling you, you must attempt to use your faith. You must attempt to use your faith first and foremost to solve a personal need in your life. And you don't only use your faith to solve a personal need in your life. You must attempt to use your faith to grow the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. You must attempt to use your faith to grow the kingdom of God. Come on, say, to use my faith is different from having faith. How many of us have shoes at home that we have never used? You have shoes at home that you have never used? Is it beautiful on your feet? How are we going to be sure? Because you have not used it. Are you sure that if you put on the shoe, the sole is not going to come off? Why? Because you have never used it. So is it when you don't use your faith, you are not sure whether that faith is going to fail or it's going to be working. So faith that is hard is different from faith that is used. The theory of faith is different from the practice of faith. The faith that you have in the lab, church, the faith that you have in the church service, church, is different from the faith that you have in real life situation. The faith that you have in the service, in the church, is different from the faith that you have in real life situation. I don't know, maybe you have ever found yourself in a situation that there is nothing at home to eat. Many of you have found yourself in those kind of category. Nothing at all to eat. I was telling my children, because when I was growing up, let me tell you this. Some of us have passed that stage. You will not go back to that stage. But I share a testimony with my children, because when I was growing up in the Lord, I once had somebody that brought me up, he said he didn't have anything to eat. And I've read testimonies like that also about families in America who had nothing to eat. And you know what they did? He just called his family around and said, "Can we gather together to pray?" This is an example of faith in the marketplace. He said, "Can we gather around to pray?" And they gathered around to pray. And they closed some place, empty place, on the dining. And they were gathered together to pray. And they began to pray. They didn't know how long they prayed, but the father was like saying, "Father, we thank you for this rice." All the kind of food that they wanted to eat, they were praying and praying and praying. And then by the time they said, "We bless this food in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen." Somebody knocked on the door. An old man knocked on the door and said, "Yes, you know what, we got some moments ago, the Holy Spirit just put it in my heart that I should cook this particular type of dish and bring it to your family. I don't know how, I don't know why, but I've just cooked it." And as they were saying, "In Jesus' name you pray," the empty seat became the real dish. Now that's what I'm talking about, faith in the marketplace. That is when you are down to nothing, when you don't have anything. What have you used your faith to accomplish? Let me share what I'm talking about again. Some of us have never been in that situation. So you don't understand what it means to use faith to overcome plane crash. Have you ever been in a situation? No, I'm not talking about the bombs. If you traveled in the air for so many times, you are used to bombs. And I'm sure you have not passed the Bermuda Island. Have you heard about the Bermuda Island? The Bermuda Island is the spot on the world where they believe that every plane that crosses it is going to be pulled down. I'm just joking anyway. But what will you do? What will you do? Now, you see, it's easy to come to church and then talk about faith, and you think that faith is just something that is abstract, something that you cannot see, something that you cannot touch, something that you cannot touch it. But church, every one of you under the sound of my voice, what will you do with your faith if you are in a plane that is about to crash? They announced and told you that the first engine is gone. As you are saying, "Father, let the second engine take us home," they announce again and say the second engine is gone. Hallelujah. What are you going to do? Will you shout hallelujah and say, "Lord, I don't know, but there's going to be an engine. I don't know where the engine is going to come down, but I know I'm not going to die in an accident by plane crash." So what will you do? That is what I'm talking about. When you face a life and death situation, will your faith be kept in your pocket or will your faith come out? Have you seen people when accidents are about to happen? Do you know what they do? They start shouting. Some of them will shout their mother's name. Some of them will shout their father's name. Only a few will say, "In the name of Jesus." Once remember a man of God, and some of us know him, but there's no need to mention names here. And he was traveling, and then himself and his wife, and the two men of God particularly, and the car they were driving in started somersaulting. As the car they were driving in was somersaulting, you know the usual highway in our country that there is used to be an embankment, a real concrete embankment. If a car is somersaulting and hit that embankment, it smashes the car into pieces, and every occupant has stand a chance of dying. And as the car was about to hit that embankment, he shouted, "This car will not hit the embankment in the name of Jesus," and the car grounded to an halt. A man of God was traveling in a particular car, and the car was going in front of him, and the tire burst, and the car somersaulted and started rolling and was about to, you know, hit the embankment that same way. And the man said, "No, this car will not hit the embankment." That's what I'm talking about. Come on, say, "Father." In other words, when your faith is brought to test, not inside the church, but outside the church, when your faith is brought to test, not on a Sunday morning or Sunday evening, because the effect of the faith tonic you received in the morning is still there. When your faith is tested on Monday, will it still produce testimony? So I'm talking about faith in the marketplace. Faith that is not only strong in church services. Faith that is not only strong on Sundays. I'm talking about faith that produces results on Monday. I'm talking about faith that produces results on Tuesday. I'm talking about faith that is conscious of testimony on Wednesday. I'm talking about faith that is conscious of testimony on Thursdays. I'm talking about faith that produces testimony on Friday. I'm talking about prayer that is returned with manifestations on Saturday. I'm talking about faith that never fails. I'm talking about faith that is ever trusting. I'm talking about faith that is ever believing. If you are the one, come on, shout, "Lord, I believe.
Lord, I
the marketplace. So faith in the classroom, in church services on Sunday, is different from faith in the marketplace, at work, in school, or in your businesses between Monday and Saturday. Faith, number four, that is static or stagnated, is not the same with a faith that is in motion and on fire. Hallelujah. You have what I said? Faith that is static and stagnated is not the same thing as the faith that is in motion and is on fire. Faith that is very strong when you are young is not the same thing as faith that is very stronger when you are older. There's a man in scriptures like that. Look at Joshua chapter 14. This guy's faith was strong when he was young. But when he grew old, his faith never grew dim. Look at what happened to him. He sent the children of, look at verse, Joshua chapter 14, verse 6. Then the children of Judah came unto Joshua and Gilgal, and Caleb the son of Jephunne, the Canaanite, said unto him, thou knowest the thing that the Lord has said unto Moses, man of God, concerning me and thee in Kadesh Barnea. I pray that when you are older than this, may you still call the word of God that has been spoken into your heart, that has been spoken into your life, into manifestations. Did you hear me, church? I pray that when you are older than this, may you call God's attention to the manifestations of the promise he has given you. So this guy went to Moses and said, 40 years old was I when Moses, the servant of the Lord, sent me from Kadesh Barnea to spy out the land, and I brought him word again as it was in my heart. Nevertheless, my brethren that went with me made the heart of the people to melt, but I wholly follow the Lord my God. Now, Moses swear on that day, saying, surely the land whereon my feet are trodden shall be thy inheritance, and thy children's children forever, because thou hast wholly followed the Lord. What happened? Now behold, the Lord hath kept me alive, as he said, this 45 years. How old is this guy? 85. 40 plus 45. 40 plus 45. 85. It's not up to 1 year that you got to New Zealand. You don't even believe the things you believe God for in Nigeria. How many years have you spent in this land? The things you got by faith, are you getting them again? You are doubting God. When you challenge elements, you challenge humans, you challenge spirit, you challenge demon, you challenge anything that challenges your life, but you want to give up to all those things now. Look at this guy. For 45 years, his faith was consistent. He was saying, I'm going to get it. I don't know who I'm talking to this morning. Come on, say, for the next 45 years, my faith is going to be stronger. What I'm telling you is that your faith must produce what it has never produced before in this land. Why? Because I'm teaching you. Why? Because we are in a beautiful place, parish. Why? Because we have chosen to live a different life. If you believe me, it's going to come to pass. Yeah. Eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, nor have entered into the hearts of men the things which God. I was chatting with somebody yesterday. The way I was inviting him for the healing service, and he's a pastor. And the way he was telling me, I knew from the way he was writing his text that he believed that healing, deliverance, is gone with the apostles. He told me, he said, but in those days, but in Athenosy, he was referring to the scriptures that that is where only he has said, but I saw the dead raised in my in Africa, and I can see it here. Come on, if you believe, say amen.
Amen.
Your faith must not grow weak. This man was so strong in faith that he was calling for giants at 85. He was calling for the mountains that the Lord has promised him at 85. Faith on standby. Faith on standby is not the same as faith that is performing and active. Failing and falling faith is different from the faith that produces resolve, ever-increasing faith. And the only way your faith can increase is by using it. It's by using it. If you don't use it, tell the person next to you, if you don't use it, you will lose it. You have a great opportunity before you to use it. If your faith is not active or working, church, it is dead. If your faith is not active or working, it is dead. If your faith is not active or working, it is dead. If your faith is not active or working, it is dead. Come on, say, Holy Spirit, let my faith be ignited with your fire again. Do you know sometimes the way we sit in church is a reflection of our heart? I had a quote, and I know if you listen to some motivational speakers in Nigeria, you'll have listened to them. They say, you cannot travel within and stand still without. The way we approach life, the way we sit in service, the way we move about, you know, looking for opportunities, is a reflection of our faith. And do you know that quote is from a book that was written centuries ago by a man called Allen something, as a man thinketh. I get the material. Say to yourself, say, you cannot travel within and stand still without. Praise the name of the Lord. The way you say amen, the way you pray, the way you go about looking for opportunity, the way you refuse to give up, church, if God has truly brought you to this land, you won't use your PhD certificate to be claiming the floor.
Hallelujah.
If God has truly brought you to this land, if this land is not going to prosper what God has given to you, and you know God gave it to you, go back to where you're coming from. Hallelujah.
Amen.
That's what I'm talking about. We travel over the sea, we travel over lands, and we come here and we surrender our faith to online circumstances. We surrender our faith to policy failures. We surrender our CVs to racial impossibilities. If your faith cannot produce result, your faith is dead. Some people's faith exists in form of promissory notes. When I was younger and I was in school, there was one subject I hated so much. When they were teaching me, I was sleeping in class. I didn't know that's what is going to make me to get money. I never knew. Let me just crack a joke here. I never knew. They call it bank reconciliatory system. That's where I got my money from. When I was in school and they were teaching, so I'm going to say some things from my knowledge of it now. But I discovered it's so relevant to our faith. When I was in school and they were teaching me that thing, I was asleep. When I got my first offer in Nigeria, Evans Publishers, you know what? The first bid they gave me, I was the officer in charge of reconciling all the banks of Evans and Depots all over Nigeria. I didn't know how to do it, and I had to run. So the senior accountant looked at me and said, but you finished with 2-1. And my 2-1 was my 2-1. I didn't steal it. So I went back home and took my textbook and dusted it and read it and practiced it. And I'll get back to office and I'll be looking for 5 kobo, maybe in your depot. And I won't sleep. My mind will be on that 5 kobo. Following day, I'll get it. I became good. When I graduated and I started my own accounting firm, guess where I was using to help clients to discover fraud? Bank reconciliation. Because sometimes things that we neglect, things that we say we are going to jump over, are the things that God wants to use to prosper you. Please don't jump at this issue of faith. There's something God is bringing out. There's something God wants to use it to produce in your life. Don't let your faith. Do you know there are so many forms of issues when you go to bank? Some people's faith are in form of promissory note. They are in form of bounced checks, in form of dishonored checks, in form of unpresented checks. Those are different classifications of faith. Bounced check is different from unpresented checks or dishonored check. Your faith has been presented, but it was dishonored. Don't give up, present it again. Your faith has been presented, but dishonored. Don't give up, present it again. Your faith has been presented, but bounced. Before you go back tomorrow, something will be inside that account, and you will catch your testimony. Some people's faith are in form of bounce checks, dishonored checks, unpresented checks. Others' faith are always in physical cash, raw, dynamic, available, ready to make physical transactions in exchange for testimonies and miraculous manifestations of God's power.
Hallelujah.
Some people's faith is ever living and active. But some, their faith is dead. And if you are really using your faith, if it's not producing at least a testimony per week about your life, about your winning souls or God's kingdom or something in your life, I'm telling you something is wrong with your faith. Can we just do something? You know, people do hallelujah challenge. Different kind of challenge. Can we do a challenge in this church? You know the challenge? Faith. Can we declare a challenge for a faith-producing testimony per week? Can we declare the challenge? Are you ready for the challenge? Next week Sunday. You know, they come around and they say, oh, is anybody having testimony? I guess you have. Maybe you don't want to share it. But it's high time that the testimony become multiplied, that even if you don't share it, we will see it. And there's some testimony that you will can't just but share it. Your faith must be producing testimony. They come around and say, well, everybody with a testimony. Do you know sometimes why I don't share my testimony? Because some of you may not believe. I just got one. Just last week. And when I was sharing with it with my wife was like, eh? But if I share it, you won't believe it. You will think maybe I just was praying and the Lord said, do this, and I stood up and I did it. And I kept quiet. And it didn't happen. And then 1 week after it produces. Hallelujah. Amen. Let your faith give you a testimony every week. That faith can give you a testimony every week. That faith can give you a testimony every week. That faith can give you a testimony every week. Say my faith. So go to your setting, the setting mode of your faith, and reset it to active. The way you block people on Twitter, block people on Facebook, do all those things, you know the way you go to? Go to the settings of your faith and remove it from default and put it in active. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So faith in the marketplace demonstrated. What then, as we close, is the market? I want you to listen carefully to this one. This market is the location or medium of exchange where what you cannot see. I'm going to say it 3 times. This market that we're talking about is the medium or exchange where what you cannot see, what you cannot taste, and what you cannot touch, which is your faith, is used in exchange for what you can see, what you can taste, or what you can touch. Say it again. This faith in a marketplace is the location or medium of exchange spiritually, where what you cannot see, where what you cannot taste, where what you cannot touch is used in exchange to produce what you can see, to produce what you can taste, and to produce what you can touch. This faith in the marketplace is the medium where what you cannot see, what you cannot taste, what you cannot touch is used to produce what you can see, what you can taste, and what you can touch. Hallelujah. There are so many things that our faith can produce for us. People buy houses and still go on mortgage for 35 years. Your faith can buy a house for you in this land cash. Because I've seen people do it. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
You know, by faith, the whole world was created from the things that be not to everything that we can see. Hallelujah. As I close, I share three stories with you. Three biblical stories of people that took their faith to the marketplace. And I will not be able to read all the scriptures, but let's go. There's one that challenged me most. I want to talk to your heart. The first one was in 2 Kings chapter 6. The story of Elisha and his school of prophet boys. I know you've heard the story before. And these three stories that I'm going to be sharing from scripture, I'm going to define it into impossible, the faith. Now, listen. Sorry, so that I won't miss the revelation. Some of you know that many of you have stock. You've ever bought stock before. You have stock shares. That's what I mean. You have shares in companies. You have abandoned it. Go and put it into CSCS. One day it will come alive. Praise the name of the Lord. Because I made some little change when it was booming in Nigeria. But you know, in stock exchange, they say the exchange is bearish or bullish. Do you know, as we're talking about faith in the marketplace, some of our faith are bearish. Have you seen a bear before? That's bear for you. So slow. So sluggish. So useless. So wasteful. Because it will waste opportunity. A bear still feeds on other animals, but it's so slow. Have you seen a bull charge before? Point to somebody and say, let your faith become bullish. Hallelujah. Now let's go to the story. The first story is in this place. Say the sons of the prophets, I'll paraphrase and then we go to the Lord in prayer. Say the sons of the prophets are still looking for the modern day version of this story. Be looking for the modern day version of this story. They went and they said, we want to go and cut a beam. And they persuaded Elisha and said, Elisha, go with us. So they went. And as every one of them were cutting the trees, by the time they finished cutting all the trees, somebody was cutting a very big tree. And all of a sudden, as he was cutting it, the axe head fell into the waters. And when it fell into the waters, all of a sudden, they said, alas, my master, for it was borrowed. And he said, oh, if you were the one in that marketplace, what would you do? Let's go and buy another axe. Do you know people don't change things here? They buy new ones. Things you repair back home, you buy new ones. Things you lay hands on in Nigeria to come alive again, you buy new ones. Because you don't have money to buy it. And it's only your faith that's going to make you to keep enjoying that thing. How many things did you pray that you shouldn't die in Nigeria that you are thinking of replacing now? So, a man of God said, do this something that I don't still understand. He said, can you get me a stick? And he got him a stick and he threw the stick into the water. And the heart said, floated. I don't know what you call that, but that is real faith in the marketplace. There was a sister once, I had her testimony. She worked in the bank in Nigeria. And she was going to an arts fellowship. And as she was going to the arts fellowship, the manager that day decided to trust her with the key to the vault. And she climbed on a ladder, rushing to the arts fellowship. I'm telling you, faith in the marketplace. And as she was rushing to the marketplace, she had an accident. And by the time she stood up from the Okada, one of the things that God lost was the key to the vault. She's in trouble. I'm telling you, true life testimony here. When will our house fellowship come alive like that? And she got to the house fellowship. And she just managed that the house leader, she just finished the message. And she said, please, I want us to pray. I have never seen God that way before. She said, I want us to pray. And by the time she finished narrating the story, everybody had to pray. And they know if God does not intervene, she's lost the job. So people prayed, And suddenly somebody started shaking in the job, in the fellowship. And she was shaking. She started saying things that she doesn't understand. She said that she should go back to where she had the accident. And then there's a kiosk beside the accident. There's a gutter beside that kiosk. And under the inside the gutter was a plank. She should lift up the plank and she will see the key to the vault. Come on, say faith in the marketplace. Are you getting what I'm talking about? If you work in a place and the key in this place, they don't give you keys. Okay, my key is up there. They don't give you keys. They give you some sensor keys that you can use to open the office. I will show you. If something gets lost, what will you do? Put your hand on your head and say, I'm finished. We're talking about faith in the marketplace. Let's look at another story so that we can close. The Bible talked about John chapter 6. Because I'll finish with the one that challenges me most. Say, in John chapter 6, Jesus Christ was going to the wilderness. He said, we will go with you. And when they got there, he saw that people were so many. The only people they can count were the men. 5,000 men were there. So if 5,000 men were there, you can know that devil is the number of children and women. Some people estimated them to be 12,000. And he said, guys, we need to get these people to eat. And he said, no. One of the disciples said, no. We can't get them food to eat. If we're going to get these people food to eat, it's going to cost us 200 penny worth. Sometimes when you are reading the Bible, you don't compare Bible with Bible. Do you know the minimum wage in the Bible? A penny. I saw it by contrasting the scripture. The minimum wage in the Bible is a penny. So he's saying that the wages of 200 people, they will need it to feed the crowd. John chapter 6. Jesus said, let them sit down. And he took it and prayed and broke the bread. And I don't know what happened. Maybe it was in the hands of Jesus or it was in the hands of the apostle. But I have a perception in my heart. Those bread were not multiplied in the hands of Jesus. It was multiplied in the hands of the apostles. If one of the apostles had collected a bread and sat down, said, nothing would happen. The apostles just noticed that when they cut the first bread and give to Brotobi, before they move to Sister Esther, the bread has become whole again. They cut it again and give it to Emmanuel. Before they got Emmanuel, the bread became whole again. Come on, clap your hands and celebrate the miraculous. The same thing happened to the fish. Faith in the marketplace. Let's go to the last one. And this is the one that challenged me most. And this is the one that the Lord used to speak to me this morning. He says there was a woman, Mark chapter 5, verse 25. This same story is in Luke chapter 8 and in verse 41. But if you read the Luke account, you won't enjoy it. But this Mark account is so challenging. It says, a certain woman which had an issue of blood, 12 years. Come on, say 12 years is not a joke, man. Look at verse 26. And had suffered many things. And of many physicians. In other words, these doctors have taken advantage of her. She has become a cash machine for doctors. I pray that you will not have any sickness that will make you to become a cash machine for any doctor.
Amen.
This woman has become a cash machine for doctors and has spent all that she had. She kept on spending until she had nothing to spend again. Some of us, you will never use your faith for as long as you still have money in your bank account. Don't get to that stage. My money is not to cure sicknesses. Tell yourself, my money is not for replacement theory. Tell yourself, my money is not to replace things. This woman kept on thinking she had the solution until she had no more money. Must you get to that stage of your life to start using your faith? This woman, she kept on spending, but when she realized that she had spent everything that was she has, and she was not getting better, but grew worse. She came to one conclusion. God must intervene in my situation. Please, church, you still have money in your bank account, but kept on saying, God must intervene in my situation. For God says that you must not spend your money for that which is not bread. Hallelujah. And look at it. But when she heard that Jesus came in the press behind and touched his garment, and the Bible says immediately, she was, for she said, this is where I'm going to do. The word translated, she said, comes from the root word, lego. It means repeated saying. She didn't say it once. She kept on saying it. She didn't say, if I may but touch the hem of his garment once. That's what the root meaning. She kept on saying, she was leaving her house, if I can just touch Jesus' garment, I'll be whole. She got to the bus, she can just touch Jesus' garment, I'll be whole. She got to the crowd, she couldn't pass me, she kept on saying. So it was a repeated confession that produces a testimony. So she kept on saying. So when you read for she said, no, it didn't mean for she said. If you read the Amplified Version, you will read something like, she kept on saying, if I may but touch the hem of his garment, I shall be made whole. Timbo ba for work on shetty ashore. Arabio yadada. Mametu. Omuwe yaka. Those of you that speak Igbo. If I can but touch the hem of his garment, I shall be made whole. And the moment she touched it, power flowed, virtue flowed, and she was healed. Clap your hands and say, let go. But I pray that your faith will start producing results while you still have money in your bank account. Rise to your feet. Take your faith to the marketplace now and get something. Take your faith to the marketplace right now and get something. Take your faith to the marketplace right now and get something. Take your faith to the marketplace right now. Look away from your bank account. Take your faith to the marketplace right now and get something. Take your faith to the marketplace right now and get something. Pray, pray, pray in the Spirit. Pray in the Holy Ghost. Pray in the Spirit. Pray in the Holy Ghost. Pray in the Spirit. Pray in the Holy Ghost. Pray in the Spirit. Pray in the Holy Ghost. Command the unbelief to break. In the name of Jesus, command that hardened heart that is doubtful, hardened heart that is unbelieving, break in the name of Jesus. Makalibo shende keyebo zonda kalia, resete keyebo zonda kaliba zandala ha, resende keyebo zonda kalia ba zandala ha, makalima shende keyebo zonda lehe, resete keyebo kulia ba shende lehe. I want you to pray. 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 In Jesus' name, we pray.
Amen.
There are some people, whatever money is limited from giving them, limits them in life. So when money cannot give them healing, they donate it to charity. Say, Father. Whether with money or without money, I become unlimited. Open your mouth and pray like that. Whether with money or without money, I become unlimited. I become unlimited. I become unlimited. I become unlimited. Whether with money or without money, I become unlimited. I become unlimited. I become unlimited. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, faithful Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Can we sing? I just realized that the announcer did not take tithe. But let's sing this song and then we'll take tithe. I believe. So why should I worry, oh friend? Alleluia. But you must make sure you are sharing it. Share it with your husband, if possible, but don't keep it to yourself. And if you have a leading, share it with the church. But let your testimonies be per one, at least one per week. Father, just raise up your hand, stretch it at me. Father, we stand in faith. And as this your children come forth in faith, to trust you for one testimony per week, Lord, to them according to their faith. Thank you, faithful Father. You know it's done. Go back with your challenge. If you have anything to offer to the Lord, can you just lift it up? And then for 10 minutes now, if you have anything to offer to the Lord, then for 10 minutes now, I'm going to bring to the He's going to pray, help us pray on the offering, and then minister to us for 10 minutes, please. Let's just be patient. If you have anything to offer to the Lord, we have a Wi-Fi, and you can use it if you need it online. If you are paying your tithe as well, don't forget, paying your tithe is an indication of your trust in money or in God. Don't trust money, trust God. When you pay your tithe, the rest of your income will be blessed. Hallelujah. Amen. So join me this morning as he comes to pray and then minister to us, Dr. Anthony. God bless you.
Hallelujah. Amen. 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 Your church has given me 10 minutes, and with 10 minutes, I cannot do anything, but the Holy Spirit in me can do something.
Amen.
How many of you believe that?
Hallelujah!
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Can somebody read for me from Gospel of John, chapter 14, verse 14? Quick. Yes. It's written there. Oh, okay. $5. Okay. Hallelujah.
Amen. If you ask anything in my name.
If you ask anything in my name,
I will
do it. It's not me, Walto. You ask anything in my
name.
Lord's name. He said, he's promising you today morning that he's going to do it for you. How many of you believe that? He is going to do for you.
Amen.
Just your pastor was speaking about faith. Yes. If the faith is there with you, you will receive what he is going to give it to you.
Amen.
You ask anything. Anything. He is going to do it for you. Amen.
Amen.
But how is he going to do it? It says, can you go to the second verse? 15, yeah. If you love me, do you love Jesus Christ?
Yes.
Are you sure?
Yes.
With Jesus Christ, are you loving? Yesterday, there was a meeting for me yesterday evening. I was just asking, does Jesus Christ at present in this midst, is he there? Hello? Are you sure? Is he here now? Amen? But if that is the case, means I'm not following that Jesus Christ. I'm following a Jesus Christ when he said, I give peace and I have to go to my Father. Only then another comforter is going to come to the to you. You have to wait for him. If I don't go, he doesn't come. So he has gone. And now we are waiting for his second coming.
Yeah.
So is he here?
Yeah.
The Spirit of the Holy Spirit is here.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So that Spirit which he, when he said that he is going to the Father and he is going to ask the Father and Father is going to send it to you. That is what we are reading from here. And he says, and he shall give you another comforter that he may abide with you for ever. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So don't you want that gift which he has already sent over to the world? It is already among us, but it should come inside you. Only then the faith, without your knowledge, the faith will follow you. Amen.
Amen.
The faith is not following you. The faith is going to go in front of you. Amen. Nowadays we go walk in the front and the faith comes back. That is the problem. The faith has to go front. So once you receive this particular Holy Spirit, the faith is already built in. For each and everything, the faith is already there. You just go forward and it will be done. Today you have come in with bare hand, but you are going to be filled with such a manner that you are going to go back with the power of the Holy Spirit. How many of you believe in that? Hallelujah. The same Gospel of John, chapter 3, verse 5. It says, without baptizing in water and spirit, you cannot reach heaven. And it says, amen, amen, double time. Twice he says, without receiving. Yes, without receiving. Without born in water and spirit, you cannot reach heaven. Then why are we sitting here? So have we received the water baptism? Yes. And have we received this power? This is the power which was mentioned earlier. The another comforter which comes, which is already here. If you receive that, you will start receiving the gift of the Holy Spirit also. Amen. How many of you believe that? Do you want to receive that power? I'm talking about that power. That is why the Lord is leading me, the opening the way towards the world. I've traveled around about 517,000 kilometers by flight alone for the last 77 months. And not to see the country. Just to carry what the world has given to me and speak to the people and then I fly back. I've been here from Wednesday onwards. I've not seen any place yet. But I was just praying, give me an opening. Because I did not have any meeting in New Zealand. I just came here. But whereas the other places, meetings has been booked and the program has been arranged in such a manner, I just walk there. After the meeting, I just fly back. But here, it is different. But I know, by faith I came here and I'm getting meetings.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
You have the faith?
Yes.
How many of you have the faith? Be on your feet. Be on your feet. And those who really want the touch of the Holy Spirit, and those who really want the touch of the Holy Spirit, something different, what I was just speaking. How many of you want that? How many of you want to taste that? Hallelujah.
Amen.
Just speak inside your mind, body, soul. Speak to the Lord. Lord, fill me up with that another comforter. Allow me to taste differently. What do you want me to do it? Allow me to do that. Amen. Come forward. Come forward. Come forward. Hallelujah. While you are standing in front, it's not Walter who is going to do this. It's the Lord. The Spirit in me is forcing me to do it. And I'm just laying my hand to pray. Amen. Close your eyes. Raise your hand. Speak to the Lord. Lord, fill me with the power of the Holy Spirit. Don't think about anything. Your church, your husband, your wife, or anybody. Just you and Jesus Christ alone. Nothing else. Amen. Surrender yourself. Speak to yourself. Weep inside you. Allow the Spirit to come inside you. Amen. Speak inside you. Fill me. Fill me. Fill me. Fill me. Fill me. Fill me. The Lord God says, I have chosen you for some other purpose. Something different which is going to take place in you. If you have the faith, if you have to believe in that, you will receive the power. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, any evil spirit which is blocking you, out you go. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Keep on praying, keep on praying, keep on praying. In the name of the Father, yes, the Lord wants to touch you. The Spirit wants to come inside you. Are you ready to receive it? Just surrender to the Lord. Allow the Spirit to enter yourself. Give thanks to the Lord, for He is going to do that. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, receive in Jesus' name. Amen. Yes. The Lord has already touched you. Amen. You are going to taste a surprise, which you are going to shout to the world what the Lord has done for you. Do you have the faith? Do you have the faith? Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, receive the blessing from above in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, Lord, I hand over your daughter, protect her, put her in your hand, lead her in such a manner, allow her to shout to the world what you have done to him. Thank you, Jesus, for you going to do that. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. In the name of the Father, surrender to the Lord. Surrender to the Lord. You will be surprised what the Lord is going to do for you. But as of now, you are on the worldly thoughts. You have not surrendered to the Lord so far. The Lord says, you ask anything in my name, I am ready to give you. You have the faith, you ask, you are going to receive it. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, receive in Jesus' name. Amen. In the name of the Father, yes, the Lord says, as your church pastor was saying, there was a woman, for a long time she was not feeling well. It's not like that. There is something which is going taking place in you. You have to get an answer, and you are asking, you are praying, and for a long time you have not received the answer. But the Lord says, that woman, by faith, she touched the cloth of Jesus Christ, and it has been cured. The Lord is asking you, by faith, if you have that faith, just touch. Even the people, the followers is going around you, they cannot understand what has taken place. But my Lord Jesus Christ can identify who has touched, because the power is gone from you. That is going to take place in you. Do you believe in that? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, receive in Jesus' name. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, hand over fully to the Lord. He is going to take you to a different direction. Do you believe in that? Leave it to Him by faith. He is going to lead you. He is going to open the doors for you. Where you will be surprised, your church will be surprised, your family will be surprised in such a manner. Talk talked to them, "It is my Lord who has done this for you." In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, receive the promise of what the Lord has given to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Something different in your life from the worldly thought is going to take place. But still, don't leave the Lord away from you. Always follow, always listen to what He is memorizing into you. Take it inside you. Proceed according to what He speaks to you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, receive the power from above to receive what He speaks to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
The Lord God says, "I have chosen you, but you have not recognized it fully." But the Lord says, "I am going to fill you up with the power of the Holy Spirit in such a manner. What you have not done so far, it is going to take place from your tongue from this moment onwards. If you believe, proceed further. What has been asked you to speak to the people, speak frankly, because it is He who has given to you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, receive in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Shout hallelujah.
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 In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, be blessed in Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus, for giving me this opportunity. Even if it is short time, it's not my way, it's your way which you have spoken to them. Thank you, Jesus. Allow their tongue to give praise to you. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
I pray. Amen. Thank you.
With your hands to heaven and give God a shout of hallelujah.